Simon & Schuster Audio presents The House of the Scorpion by Nancy Farmer. Read by Raul Esparza.
Youth, 0 to 6. Chapter 1. In the beginning. In the beginning, there were 36 of them. 36 droplets of life, so tiny that Eduardo could see them only under a microscope. He studied them anxiously in the darkened room. Water bubbled through tubes that snaked around the warm, humid walls. Air was sucked into growth chambers. A dull red light shone on the faces of the workers as they watched their own arrays of little glass dishes. Each one contained a drop of life. Eduardo moved his dishes one after the other under the lens of the microscope. The cells were perfect, or so it seemed. Each was furnished with all it needed to grow. So much knowledge was hidden in that tiny world. Even Eduardo, who understood the process very well, was awed. The cell already understood what color hair it was to have, how tall it would become, and even whether it preferred spinach to broccoli. It might even have a hazy desire for music or crossword puzzles. All that was hidden in the droplet. Finally, the round outlines quivered and lines appeared, dividing the cells in two. Eduardo sighed. It was going to be all right. He watched the samples grow, and then he carefully moved them to the incubator. But it wasn't all right. Something about the food, the heat, the light was wrong, and the man didn't know what it was. Very quickly, over half of them died. There were only 15 now, and Eduardo felt a cold lump in his stomach. If he failed, he would be sent to the farms. And then what would become of Anna and the children, and his father, who was so old? "It's okay," said Lisa, so close by that Eduardo jumped. She was one of the senior technicians. She had worked for so many years in the dark, her face was chalk white, and her blue veins were visible through her skin. "How can it be okay?" Eduardo said. "The cells were frozen over 100 years ago. They can't be as healthy as samples taken yesterday." "That long?" the man marveled. "But some of them should grow," Lisa said sternly. So Eduardo began to worry again, and for a month everything went well. The day came when he implanted the tiny embryos in the brood cows. The cows were lined up, patiently waiting. They were fed by tubes, and their bodies were exercised by giant metal arms that grasped their legs and flexed them as though the cows were walking through an endless field. Now and then, an animal moved its jaws in an attempt to chew cud. Did they dream of dandelions? Eduardo wondered. Did they feel a phantom wind blowing tall grass against their legs? Their brains were filled with quiet joy from implants in their skulls. Were they aware of the children growing in their wombs? Perhaps the cows hated what had been done to them, because they certainly rejected the embryos. One after another, the infants, at this point no larger than minnows, died, until there was only one. Eduardo slept badly at night. He cried out in his sleep, and Anna asked what was the matter. He couldn't tell her. He couldn't say that if this last embryo died, he would be stripped of his job. He would be sent to the farms, and she, Anna, and their children, and his father, would be cast out to walk the hot, dusty roads. But that one embryo grew until it was clearly a being with arms and legs and a sweet, dreaming face. Eduardo watched it through scanners. "You hold my life in your hands," he told the infant. As though it could hear, the infant flexed its tiny body in the womb until it was turned toward the man, and Eduardo felt an unreasoning stir of affection. When the day came, Eduardo received the newborn into his hands as though it were his own child. His eyes blurred as he laid it in a crib and reached for the needle that would blunt its intelligence. "Don't fix that one," said Lisa, hastily catching his arm. "It's a Mateo Alacrán. They're always left intact." "Have I done you a favor?" thought Eduardo as he watched the baby turn its head toward the bustling nurses in their starched white uniforms. "Will you thank me for it later?" Chapter 2. The Little House in the Poppy Fields. Matt stood in front of the door and spread his arms to keep Celia from leaving. The small, crowded living room was still blue with early morning light. The sun had not yet lifted above the hills, marking the distant horizon.
"What's this?" the woman said. "You're a big boy now, almost 6. You know I have to work."
She picked him up to move him out of the way.
"Take me with you,"
begged Matt, grabbing her shirt and wadding it up in his hands.
"Stop that."
Celia gently pried his fingers from the cloth.
"You can't come, mi vida. You must stay hidden in the nest like a good little mouse. There are hawks out there that eat little mice."
"I'm not a mouse," Matt yelled.
He shrieked at the top of his voice in a way he knew was irritating. Even keeping Celia home long enough to deliver a tongue-lashing was worth it. He couldn't bear being left alone for another day. Celia thrust him away.
"Cállate! Shut up! Do you want to make me deaf? You're just a little kid with cornmeal for brains."
Matt flopped sullenly into the big easy chair. Celia immediately knelt down and put her arms around him.
"Don't cry, mi vida. I love you more than anything in the world. I'll explain things to you when you're older."
But she wouldn't. She had made the same promise before. Suddenly, the fight went out of Matt. He was too small and weak to fight whatever drove Celia to abandon him each day.
"Will you bring me a present?"
he said, wriggling away from her kiss.
"Of course, always,"
the woman cried. So Matt allowed her to go, but he was angry at the same time. It was a funny kind of anger, for he felt like crying too.
The house was so lonely without Celia singing, banging pots, or talking about people he had never seen and never would see.
Even when Celia was asleep, and she fell asleep easily after long hours cooking at the big house, the rooms felt full of her warm presence. When Matt was younger, it hadn't seemed to matter. He'd played with his toys and watched the television. He'd looked out the window where fields of white poppies stretched all the way to the shadowy hills. The whiteness hurt his eyes, and so he turned from them with relief to the cool darkness inside. But lately, Matt had begun to look at things more carefully. The poppy fields weren't completely deserted. Now and then, he saw horses. He knew them from picture books, walking between the rows of white flowers. It was hard to tell who rode them in all that brightness, but it seemed the riders weren't adults, but children, like him. And with that discovery, grew a desire to see them more closely. Matt had watched children on television. He saw that they were seldom alone. They did things together, like building forts, or kicking balls, or fighting. Even fighting was interesting when it meant you had other people around. Matt never saw anyone except Celia, and once a month, the doctor. The doctor was a sour man, and didn't like Matt at all.
Matt sighed. To do anything, he would have to go outdoors,
which Celia said again and again was very dangerous. Besides, the doors and windows were locked. Matt settled himself at a small wooden table to look at one of his books. "Pedro el Conejo," said the cover. Matt could read, slightly, both English and Spanish. In fact, he and Celia mixed the two languages together, but it didn't matter. They understood each other. Pedro el Conejo was a bad little rabbit who crawled into Señor McGregor's garden to eat up his lettuces. Señor McGregor wanted to put Pedro into a pie, but Pedro, after many adventures, got away. It was a satisfying story. Matt got up and wandered into the kitchen. It contained a small refrigerator and a microwave. The microwave had a sign reading, "Peligro! Danger!" and squares of yellow notepaper saying, "No, no, no, no." To be extra sure, Celia had wrapped a belt around the microwave door and secured it with a padlock. She lived in terror that Matt would find a way to open it while she was at work and cook his little gizzards, as she put it. Matt didn't know what gizzards were, and he didn't want to find out. He edged around the dangerous machine to get to the fridge. That was definitely his territory. Celia filled it with treats every night. She cooked for the big house, so there was always plenty of food. Matt helped himself to sushi.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.